never dream that my four little children one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today.
U.S. forces, give the nod. It's a setback for your cause.
I'm talking about the real owners now. The big, wealthy business interests that control things and make all the important decisions. Forget the politicians. Politicians are put there to give you the idea that you have freedom of choice. You don't. You have no choice. You have owners. They own you. They own everything. They own all the important land. They own and control the corporations. They've long since bought and paid for the Senate, the Congress, the state houses, the city halls. They got the judges in their back pockets. And they own all the big media companies, so they control just about all of the news and information you get to hear. They got you by the balls. They spend billions of dollars every year lobbying to get what they want. Well, we know what they want. They want more for themselves and less for everybody else. But I'll tell you what they don't want. They don't want a population of citizens capable of critical thinking. They don't want well-informed, well-educated people capable of critical thinking. They're not interested in that. That doesn't help them. That's against their interest. That's right. They don't want people who are smart enough to sit around the kitchen table to figure out how badly they're getting fucked by a system that threw them overboard 30 fucking years ago. They don't want that. You know what they want? They want obedient workers. Obedient workers. People who are just smart enough to run the machines and do the paperwork and just dumb enough to passively accept all these increasingly shittier jobs with the lower pay, the longer hours, the reduced benefits, the end of overtime, and the vanishing pension that disappears the minute you go to collect it. And now they're coming for your Social Security money. They want your fucking retirement money. They want it back. So they can give it to their criminal friends on Wall Street. And you know something? They'll get it. They'll get it all from you sooner or later because they own this fucking place. It's a big club, and you ain't in it.
Dollar ain't shit, and it's taxed to no end. Those are rich men. Those are rich men.
Well, may we say, God save the Queen. Because nothing will save the Governor General.
God save the Queen! The fascist regime!
Boxing is nothing like going to war with machine guns, bazookas, hand grenades, bomber airplanes. My intention is to box to win a clean fight. But in war, the intention is to kill, 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 and continue killing innocent people.
Each time a man stands up for an ideal, or acts to improve the lot of others, or strikes out against injustice, he sends forth a tiny ripple of hope, and crossing each other from a million different centers of energy and daring, those ripples build a current which can sweep down the mightiest walls of oppression and resistance.
Which side are you on, boys? Which side are you on? Which side are you on, boys? Which side?
I shouldn't be up here. I should be back in school on the other side of the ocean. Yet you all come to us young people for hope. How dare you? You have stolen my dreams and my childhood with your empty words. And yet, I'm one of the lucky ones. People are suffering. People are dying. Entire ecosystems are collapsing. We are in the beginning of a mass extinction. And all you can talk about is money and fairy tales of eternal economic growth. How dare you?
There are many whites who are trying to solve the problem, but you never see them going under the label of liberals. That white person that you see calling himself a liberal is the most dangerous thing in the entire Western Hemisphere. He's the most deceitful. He's like a fox, and a fox is always more dangerous in the forest than the wolf. You can see the wolf coming. You know what he's up to. But the fox will fool you. He comes at you with his mouth shaped in such a way that even though you see his teeth, you think he's smiling and taking for a friend.
I can no longer remain in today's Democratic Party that's under the complete control of an elitist cabal of warmongers who are driven by cowardly wokeness.
And that's why psychos run the world. Because they don't give a fuck. They don't feel guilt. They don't give a shit. They'll fucking kill anybody. You know? And nice people, we should be killing them, but we don't because we can't deal with the guilt. Right? And what do psychos do? They stay in power by killing loud, nice people. Martin Luther King, loud, nice. I know he banged a bunch of broads. Who gives a fuck? Guy was fucking up there crushing it. If nice people start killing psychos, okay, maybe then you wouldn't have a swirl of trash the size of Texas in the middle of the fucking Pacific Ocean. Do we work on that now? Because there's psychos in the world, and all they end up doing is trying to keep improving golf equipment so these man-titted fucking cunts can keep a ball on the fairway.
I punched him dead in his eyes.
Who are you crawling the pitch?
Mate, you spoke so well at that Tweed rally the other day. So yeah, you got nothing to be nervous about. I guess that's a good place to start, really. Like, just explain who you are and what your connection to this issue is.
I'm Palestinian. I was born a Palestinian refugee in Lebanon. And I guess from that place, I've always been connected to the issue. We emigrated to, well, we bounced around a little bit in Europe, and then we ended up in England. And so I kind of grew up there and was kind of, you know, grew up around that movement in England.
Interesting that you're part of that Palestinian diaspora, because I was following a story the other day, one of the most awful stories that's come out of this war as it pertains to people who are Palestinian living abroad. It was the unbelievably horrific murder of a six-year-old Palestinian boy in Chicago who was stabbed 26 times by his 71-year-old landlord while his mother was locked in the bathroom listening to it all unfold. There's not really words to describe what went down there, but I guess it just goes to show that even once you escape the horrors of the seemingly endless conflict in Gaza and the West Bank and flee to safety, you're still not safe.
Well, actually, yeah, you know, these things I think are really linked to the demonization of Palestinian people. You know, like when politicians sort of act in shock and horror after these terrible events unfold, it's absolutely ridiculous, because you know they dehumanize Palestinians as this kind of, you know, a terrible race that wants to wipe Jews off the map and is murderous just like the Nazis. And if people hear that, then they will believe it. And if you believe that sort of thing, then of course, you know, these sorts of horrible incidents happen more and more. I mean, this is because of the sort of real vilification of the Palestinian nation.
Mm. And on the flip side of that, there's also been alleged, I guess, upturn in anti-Semitism. You know, I was listening to a news report yesterday, a supposed 500% increase in anti-Semitism in Australia at the moment. And you know, it's really hard to know whether these kinds of stats are true. I'm sure there has been an uptick in anti-Semitism from certain sections of the community, but at the same time, it's very hard to trust at this point the mainstream media's coverage of this issue, knowing that the mainstream media in Australia, you know, if you're a senior editor or a senior reporter in any of the major newspapers, you get flown to Israel on press junkets, and where they get the opportunity to curry influence and curry favor with you, and hence you end up with this really warped kind of reportage of the plight of Israelis or Israel, I should say, and the Defense Force and Jews in general. I hope there isn't an uptick in anti-Semitism. That's awful. I've had many Jewish friends over the years. I grew up in Bondi, like it's a hub of the Jewish community, all fleeing World War II. The 5'8" my football team was a Jew. Like, so I hope there isn't a lot of Jewish people out there suffering as a result of this conflict, because it's not on them. There's many Jews who are in favor of Palestine, who just want peace.
I mean, there definitely has been an upturn in anti-Semitism, and it's awful. You know, like there are horrible people in the world, and they do horrible things, and they blame a group of people for things that they haven't done, as you said. You know, I have great connections with beautiful Jewish and Israeli people, and they are telling me of terrible things that they're experiencing, and it's absolutely awful. And can never be condoned for anything. Yes, there is definitely a very one-sided narrative. I think that the years of vilifying Muslims in Afghanistan and Syria and all these places has definitely led to that. And I think now we're seeing such crazy vilification of Palestinian people that's really increasing on the anti-Palestinian side, Islamophobia, all these things, you know. And it's creating division, and division helps certain politicians, you know, the ones that are going for sort of nationalist votes, you know. And so we've seen a terrible increase in racism, and it's absolutely awful. You know, that you can't fight for the rights of Palestinian people by taking away rights from any other people, and vice versa. You know, we the only way to peace is when everybody has rights and nobody is discriminated against. And so we stand, you know, firmly behind our Jewish brothers and sisters and family, you know, in support of their rights and to fight anti-Semitism. And we urge them to stand behind us. When they see stuff that isn't okay, we urge them to stand behind us and call it out in their communities too.
Yeah, well said. And I don't want to conflate those two issues, expressing my distrust over the mainstream media and the reporting of that uptick in anti-Semitism. They are actually separate, just to be clear. But yeah, it's a concern right now. The way this conflict's being covered, there's been two pretty controversial open letters that have been signed by journalists from major news organizations, the New York Times being one. There was an open letter that was signed by a couple of employees of that publication regarding their coverage of the conflict, and those two employees were sacked. And then in Australia, actually, we had a similar situation unfolding just over the last couple of days. I'm just going to try and bring it up here. Hold on. Oh, it's a bit garbled. But yeah, basically the same issue where we had a lot of employees of the Channel 9 News Network, which now owns, I believe, The Age and the SMH, and again, expressing their concern over lopsided coverage of this issue, which, as I mentioned, is the result of the Israeli government currying favor with journalists via these press junkets and stuff like that. And that was that concern was relayed by Michael West, the investigative journalist, who's got a great bit on YouTube about how it really works behind the scenes there at these media organizations with the coverage and the influence that the Israeli government has over journalists in this country and politicians for that matter. But so can you, I saw you speak at that Tweed protest recently, you know, can you share some of what you told us that day?
Yeah, I mean, at that protest, I was really wanting to direct my message to the Australian government more than anything. And it was really about, you know, the minimum levels of moral decency, I would put it. In a place like Gaza, with that sort of level of bombing, I mean, Israel has reportedly dropped 25,000 tons of explosives on Gaza. That works out as 66 tons of explosives per kilometer. You know, the devastation we're seeing there is at a sort of industrial level. I mean, two Hiroshima bombs. It's a tiny place. So the idea that that level of carnage and slaughter could ever be justified, directed mostly at a civilian population, is just totally immoral. And so really our point was, Palestinian innocent lives are just as important as Israeli innocent lives. And to think of it any other way is not only immoral, but actually really corrupt, like at a fundamental level. So really the message was that all lives are equal, and we cannot abhor the killing of one set of people and then justify the killing of another set of people. That's a totally wrong position. And I feel that, you know, perhaps it needed to be told in a really strong way that you're doing this on purpose and it's absolutely morally bankrupt.
Mm, absolutely. And you also shared some interesting history from Palestine that I think a lot of people aren't aware of, and you certainly wouldn't be aware of if you were following the mainstream news coverage of this issue. And that is just the kind of secular society that Palestine is. I mean, a lot of people associate Palestine with Hamas, this hardline Islamic organization, and hardline Islam and terrorism and these kinds of things. And that's a product of the lopsided coverage. But in fact, it's a very different society to that. Can you share a bit of that history?
Well, yeah, Palestinians, you know, obviously are from the Holy Land, are an indigenous population of the Holy Land. The DNA of Palestinians is the closest to the Semites of the Bible and the Torah. And so we have a deep connection and history to that land. But more than that, it's a melting pot of all the religions, the main three religions in that area. So we've had holy pilgrims coming, we've had crusaders, we've got Christians, Muslims, and Jews. And we have a very distinct identity. We're not the same as Jordanians or you know. And the sort of Israeli propaganda that we're just some random Arabs without any country, that sort of thing, it's ridiculous. Actually, of all the Palestinians, ones living in Palestine and Gaza, the ones living in refugee camps around Israel, and the ones in the general diaspora like me, it's estimated 10 to 15% of us are Christian. And that's because we are a different mix of people because we're from the Holy Land, you know, and a native and indigenous to that area and should be given indigenous rights.
And so fast forward to the present, and Hamas is dominating Gaza, and the, you know, both the terrorist faction and the political faction. You know, what's your take on Hamas? I assume you have friends and family still in Palestine. What is their take on Hamas? Like how legitimate are they, and do they really represent Palestinian people?
Well, Hamas is a funny thing because the guy who started it, Yassin, was like a sort of half blind, crippled cleric, you know, and he wrote that awful anti-Semitic charter, you know, and it is a terrible thing. And of course, Hamas didn't really flourish under that, of course, because Palestinians were like, well, who are these crazy people? Like, what? You want to wipe Israel up? What are you going to do it with, like, stones and rockets against a nuclear power? You know, it was a thing that you know, very few people wanted to support. And Hamas really grew because Israel allowed it to gain charity status. They actually gave it charity status.
And funded it.
Yes, absolutely.
They completely orchestrated the beginnings of that organization, and that was in the last episode of System Failure. We charted the history of Hamas and Israel's role in getting them to power as a offset to the Palestinian Authority, who wanted a two-state solution, who were the peaceful kind of operators in that Palestinian political paradigm. And I guess Israel preferred to have an excuse in Hamas for this kind of offensive military activity, something like that.
Absolutely, I think so. But I think things may, you know, sort of changed in 2004. In 2004, Yassin was assassinated as he came out of a mosque, and lots of people around got killed too. They just dropped a missile. And so when that happened, Hamas seemed to change to the Palestinian population. The first thing they did afterwards was they sent a peace proposal to Israel in 2004. And then in 2006, they brought out their manifesto, which was for, you know, the elections. So now they've become a real political party. And their manifesto's central point was to make peace with Israel along 1967 borders, as the unity government would have wanted. So just joining the general consensus of the Palestinian nation, making peace with Israel. And that's why they were elected. They would never have been elected if they had said, oh, we want to wipe out Israel. No one believes that. I mean, that's the stupidest plan, right? You know, and a nation with no army is going to wipe out this nuclear power. Like, it's stupid, right? But when they said, we want to make peace, Palestinians were like, oh, okay, what's going on here? And then when they got elected, they sent that peace proposal to Israel. And Israel rejected it and started a bloody coup against them. And they fought it off. And then Israel, you know, started the blockade, which has killed more people than the bombs until now, and caused abject misery. And Hamas has stuck to that position of peace along 1967 borders and repeatedly offered that to Israel. Israel's always turned it down. So, you know, to the Palestinian people, we kind of not sure what to make of Hamas, because they're this crazy, and they changed their charter. Everyone says, you know, that they want to kill Jews in their charter. No, they changed their charter, and their charter, even though it does not accept Israel, I mean, Israel doesn't accept Palestine, so it's starting from an equal position. But their charter does not call for the killing of Jews. It does not call for, you know, wiping out people or anything anti-Semitic in it. So, you know, it's confusing, Hamas. Like on one side, they seem to be acting like a legitimate resistance movement, and on the other hand, they're these like really far out, you know, Muslim Islamist people that you don't want to be in control of your country. But the problem is that the PA was seen by a lot of Palestinians as a stooge of the occupation. And a lot of people have this choice where it's either, oh, we vote for the stooge of the occupation, the PA, or we vote for these crazy, like radical people who we don't view as corrupt, but are like kind of crazy, you know. So it was really difficult for the Palestinian nation. It was like this voting for the lesser of two evils. And we all know about voting for lesser of two evils, you know. And this thing that the charter just means that they're mass murderers is, I mean, I don't know what's in the charter for the Greens Party or the Labour Party. Who reads that, right? You read what they say they're going to do when they get elected, you know, right? So that's what we all vote for. They say they're going to make peace. They seem to be, you know, not a corrupt party like the PA. And so the Palestinian nation took a chance on them, you know, and that's where we find ourselves now. And of course, we wish we hadn't, because look at this, you know, what's happening. But in hindsight's a great thing, you know, but it's very difficult to know who to vote for with such terrible candidates.
Mm. Another less reported part of this conflict is Gaza's gas reserves, which I think are worth in the billions of dollars. Can you tell us a bit about that? I know that you're active in this kind of fossil fuel space with regards activism and stuff like that. What do you know about Gaza's gas reserves and how that's factored into this conflict?
Well, it, it does seem to be something that is worth many, many billions of dollars. And Israel is very resource poor. You know, Israel's not a country that has its own gas and has to import gas from, you know, places like Egypt and all around from Saudi Arabia and stuff. So it's doubly precious to Israel. And wars have been fought for much less than this, you know, much less than that much gas. So, you know, the idea that Israel would leave that much gas on the that much money on the table in a way and not go after it is probably unlikely. And it's said that Hamas would never allow that gas to be taken. In other words, that they would attack the gas refineries if they put them there. And Hezbollah has said the same. There's big gas off Lebanon. And they've said if Israel tries to tap that, that they would attack that. So you can see that taking that gas means eliminating Hamas. It could be that these things are tied. It also could be that they're not, that they were a problem for the future and that hasn't happened yet. So it's really hard to know exactly. But yes, I can't imagine Israel would leave that much money just sitting there.
Mm. Mm. And just to be clear, this is exactly what we're talking about. This is from Reuters. So while Egypt and Israel have been producing gas in the Eastern Mediterranean for years, the Gaza marine field, about 30 kilometers off the Gaza coast, has remained undeveloped due to political disputes and conflict with Israel, as well as economic factors. Gaza marine is estimated to hold over 1 trillion cubic feet of natural gas, much more than is needed to power the Palestinian territories, and some of which could potentially be exported. The Palestinian Authority did not immediately respond to a request for comment. This article is a little bit old. We are waiting to know what exactly the Israelis have agreed to in details. We can't make a position based on a statement to the media, one Palestinian official told Reuters. Hamas official Ismail Ridwan told Reuters, "We affirm that our people in Gaza have the rights to their natural resources." And then there's this from Colonel Reuven Gal, a former chief psychologist of the Israeli Defense Force and a deputy national security advisor. He said, although it is legally under the jurisdiction of the Palestinian Authority as a result of the Oslo Accords, Israeli forces have prevented Palestinians' physical access to the offshore region and its resources. The Prime Minister's office said in a statement, this is the Israeli Prime Minister's office. Oh, there's a frog piping up. Shut up! Yeah, there he goes. Can you hear that? Anyway, the Israeli Prime Minister's office said in a statement, In the framework of the existing efforts between the State of Israel, Egypt, and the Palestinian Authority, with emphasis on Palestinian economic development and maintaining security stability in the region, it has been decided to develop the Gaza marine gas field off the coast of Gaza. Israel seeks to maintain the security and diplomatic interests of the State of Israel on the matter. So there was an agreement here prior to the outbreak of war that Israel and Palestine would develop this gas field together. The Hamas leadership should be persuaded to surrender unconditionally so that the Gazan people follow suit. Then a carefully selected new leadership, not Hamas, with Israel's approval and international OECD support, should undertake the renewal of Gaza marine gas exploitation. Gaza would be allowed to join a regional trade alliance involving Saudi Arabia, Egypt, the US, the UK, and others. Egypt would play a prominent role because it now supplies liquefied natural gas to Europe instead of Russia due to the Ukraine war. So that retired colonel is essentially saying Hamas should surrender and therefore that gas project can continue.
It's striking that he said a carefully selected government by Israel in that, you know, because it's so open, you know, the idea that the PA can be an independent government under hostile military occupation. You know, that's a thing that we haven't really seen before. Whenever there's a hostile military occupation, you get a stooge of that occupation. You never get a truly independent government that has the interests of its people at heart. And so what you're seeing here is like an economic colonization of the gas field, as we've seen in many countries around the world. You know, so, you know, a stooge government gets put in and then the resources of that country are taken away. And that's the model that they're proposing for the exploitation of the gas, you know. So the idea that Hamas should join a group of basically traitors who want to, you know, sell off the Palestinian resources, it does stink of colonial exploitation on a scale seen, you know, all over South America, all over Africa, and you know, that sort of all over, you know, Asia. So, you know, that's what they're saying. You let us exploit your oil, and great, you know, that's great. You can have a tiny offering from the table, you know, and that's the plan, you know, surrender, and we might give the Gaza people a tiny bit of this oil revenue.
Yeah, that pattern has been seen so many times throughout the world, at the behest of America and the CIA and, you know, British, European intelligence agencies overthrowing governments, installing puppet dictators who then open the door to resource extraction, as you mentioned. It's such a good point. And this is precisely one of the reasons Osama bin Laden listed in his letter to America as justification for 9/11. It was this, and that, like, it was the theft of oil from various Arab states, and that was, we read the transcript to that on the last program that went viral, obviously, on TikTok a week or two ago. So yeah, you don't ever hear this information in the Western media capitalist corporate paradigm, where these exact petrochemical and fossil fuel companies are so active in owning the media and influencing the media. You just don't get this narrative, do you?
Oh, absolutely not. I mean, for someone like me, I guess I had a head start, because as a child, I could see what was happening, you know, in Lebanon and you know, firsthand. And then I could see the news and I knew they were lying, you know, even as a child. So that sort of pattern is ongoing. I worked in news broadcasting for a while, for a company called NBC, which is an Arabic channel, very much like NBC. And it goes out all over the world and has massive viewing, does English as well. And I remember sitting in the studio and you can see the raw Reuters and Bloomberg stories coming in on one end. And of course we you know, I'm mixing stuff, and I'm looking at this story, and it's about a Palestinian child who was shot by an Israeli sniper while on the steps of his own home eating his sandwich, like, just, you know, no danger to anyone. And following that, there was a massive demonstration in Ramallah to protest against this, like, just killing, you know. And the TV station that I worked for, the news item on that said, today there was a riot in Ramallah and one Palestinian was killed. Okay, right. So that's factually correct, but a complete lie, right? It makes the aggressor these, like, riotous Palestinians. And of course, as a consequence of their riot, a Palestinian was killed. Not a Palestinian child was shot by a sniper. And then there was this thing. And I also remember as a young person going to poll tax, you know, demonstrations about black deaths in custody and all those things, and seeing how misrepresented we were. There was one where we were kind of kettled by this massive police presence and all the side roads were closed, so we couldn't go anywhere, you know. And you can't turn a march back. There's people, like, all the way back there. They don't know what's going on, and we're all getting crushed. And then the police just decided to, like, kind of just just go for us. They just move forward, man, like crushed us. There was people running away. And on the news that night, they showed a shot of people running towards the camera. And then they showed a shot of police fighting with demonstrators. So it looked like we had charged the police lines, you know, and this is BBC, like the main stations, you know, and really, it really cemented my idea that journalism and media has really become a tool of a tool for power. And of course, activists have been saying that for years, but it was so blatant. And I think it's so blatant now. You know, like the distortion of what's going on now is so blatant, you know, is so obvious that the story is so twisted. And I think people need to realize that if you can't see that journalists don't have a different point of view, no, they're trying to get across a very strong propaganda position. Another thing I learned working in broadcasting is the idea that that news is about information. News is a product as well as propaganda. And the idea is to engage and sell as much soap as possible, of course, as well. And the idea to do that is to elicit an emotional reaction from your viewer, you know, because emotions work way better than information. And the two emotions, I mean, the journalist was so open telling me all this, you know, the emotions that work really, really well are outrage and fear. They're the best ones, right? If you can elicit outrage and fear from your audience, right, you're off to a good start, you know? And so you see this kind of, in social media, it's clickbait. In TV, it's like sensationalism and twisting of the story, you know? It's so blatant, especially right now, yeah.
Oh, man. The moment the media stoops so low as to depend on these emotional responses to generate revenue, we were all fucked. Like, yeah. Because the media is so important. In this kind of information is so important. It's how we make sense of the world and then vote. And it's like the most fundamental instrument to democracy is good information. I mean, I'm tempted to ask what the solution is when confronted with a mainstream media that's so rancid and corrupt, but I already know what it is. It's to step into the space of podcasts where we have these independent actors in long form scenarios, able to convey exactly what we're talking about now. Glad you brought up the BBC, because there's a really interesting guy active on Instagram, Carrick Ryan, who is, I don't know if you followed this guy, but he's a former Australian federal agent, and he just offers really sober, balanced analysis of a conflict like this and other issues. But he's been great on this conflict, and he signaled out the BBC for airing an interview with a released Palestinian prisoner with an overdubbed translation from Arabic to English. However, this is quoting from Carrick, however, Arabic speakers soon picked up that the translation was incredibly inaccurate. In particular, a seemingly entire invented reference to Hamas was aired. Saving money on poor quality translators will undoubtedly exacerbate mistrust of media in a war where the truth is getting increasingly difficult to define. So I'll just read out the correct translation versus the erroneous translation rendered by the BBC. The Israeli occupation forces, so this is the correct translation. The Israeli occupation forces came at 10 a.m. telling us that there would be a deal, and then they imprisoned us. They've imprisoned us for a month. BBC, the Israelis came at 10 in the morning and told us that there was a deal. We were suffering from difficult circumstances. Correct translation, they are firing, throwing tear gas at us. BBC, and tear gas was fired at us. Correct translation, we female prisoners are living under constant humiliation. We keep veiled 24/7. Nobody knows anyone. BBC translation, we were wearing head covers all the time. Correct translation, prisoners with mental health issues are being treated mercilessly in the same way as healthy prisoners, being tortured and humiliated, leading to their collapse. BBC translation, The situation was humiliating and included physiological torture, in addition to cutting off the electricity for the prisoners. Correct translation, nobody helps or supports anyone. BBC, we were suffering from the cold without the electricity. Correct, they've imprisoned us for a month. As winter came, they cut off the electricity. We almost died from the cold weather. BBC translation, and no one helped us. Only Hamas cared. Those who felt our suffering, I thank them very much. Correct translation, they sprayed us with pepper spray and left us to die inside the prison. BBC translation, and we love them very much.
Oh,
fucking baffling.
Well,
that's crazy shit.
I've got a bunch of mates who work at the BBC. They've told me that many of the left wing or more balanced people have been let go, and a lot of the leadership and key positions have been filled in the last decade or so with extremely right wing actors. And the BBC has shifted like super far to the right in a short space of time. It's not a mistake that we're seeing the BBC act like, you know, Fox News or worse. You know, it's actually become a ridiculous mouthpiece of very, very right-wing people, and the repression in the BBC is gone off the charts.
So what does BBC stand for? Is it Bourgeois British Corporation or British Bourgeois Broadcasting Corporation?
Absolutely. It's bougie to the max, dude. Like, oh my God. It is seriously stuck up, honestly. You know, that old school, what tie did you used to wear? You know, like my dad, you know, is your second helicopter free? Like, you know, yeah.
And it's similar to the ABC here. You know, they make sure to hire people from various kind of token ethnic or sexual orientations, but class never registers a mention in the hallways of these media, these government media empires. And interesting to note too, like the BBC, both Israel and the BBC were essentially set up by the same people, right? That being the British government.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And what's really important to know is that, the British didn't just wash their hands of Palestine like they sort of claim. They actively armed the Jewish immigration side, knowing their character. And they very actively disarmed the Palestinian population. And they set up a deal that the Palestinian leadership were bound to reject. This is the thing Israel always says. Oh, you know, they didn't accept the deal because they hate all Jews and they want to kill Jews. No. Right. Like the deal offered to the Palestinian people, really driven by the British, was to give, you know, 30% of the people, the Jewish immigrants who'd just come over recently, very, very, very recently. They wanted to give them 56% of the land, and the Jewish ownership of the land was only 6%. 6% of private land was owned by Jewish people. You know, the rest, the 94% of private land was owned by Palestinians, farmers, shopkeepers. You know, the idea that you could give 30% of the people 56% of the land was never going to be acceptable by the Palestinian nation. And they rightly turned it down. And what happened is the other nations around, you know, Israelis always say, oh, and then they attacked us with these, you know, five nations and no, the ethnic cleansing started in 1947, not 1948, with 200 massacres and carefully planned high-level orchestration integrated with the Zionist leadership. In fact, these terrorists became, you know, prime ministers and generals of the Israeli state, and they've continued and become, their party has continued and become Likud. So, you know, this idea and the Arab nations around said, you need to make a deal that's acceptable to the Palestinian people or we'll come to the aid of the Palestinian people. And as the ethnic cleansing started and all this horrible pogrom after pogrom and people being driven off their lands, those Arab states were compelled to try and come and stop this terrible event happening, the Nakba. So this propaganda, you know, it's awful. It's not believable. And no leader would have the mandate to give 56% of their country to people who just arrived and owned almost nothing. So, you know, I've gone a bit off your question, but yeah, the idea is that it's yeah, I'm a bit lost, but yeah, the idea is that it's not this mass thing where we won't make peace and we reject everything.
I feel sorry for Israelis, because when I look at it, going back to 47, 48, you know, on the backside of the Holocaust and this awful, just indescribably horrific persecution of Jews, they then seem to get used as pawns by the British to occupy and set up a colony that preserves European and subsequently American interests in the Middle East. It's like that's a hard one to win. You know, that's a hard situation to be put in. Like it seemed like such a great deal at the time. Yeah, you're gonna get to occupy your holy land, this special place. We're gonna make it comfortable and livable and give you the authority and arms you need to protect yourself and live a happy, peaceful life where you can heal and recover from the trauma of the genocide that occurred. But they've put them in the middle. Firstly, they had to clear people off that land, and then they've put them in the middle of all these hostile states. Oh man, like how terrifying that is to live that existence, and that is the existence of Israeli people. And they are, you know, not only are they dealing with the intergenerational trauma of World War II, which must be so virulent, just even take away the ongoing conflict and perpetual state of war that they're in, just dealing with the trauma of having parents who were survivors of these concentration camps, man, that is just a rough deal. And then to be dropped in just this vat of war and hostility, mate, I really feel for the Israeli people, and there are so many that just want to live peaceful lives, not fight wars. I mean, we saw in the lead up to the outbreak of war, there was like tens, if not hundreds of thousands of people on the streets protesting against Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu for increasingly, you know, fascist leaning reforms of judicial controls. And I imagine too, like a big part of that pushback against Netanyahu was how aggressive he was being on the West Bank. And they know in Israel that you don't fucking poke the beehive, man. Like, what a fucking stupid thing to do. You're putting all of us in jeopardy. And look what's happened now. And also learning that, you know, so many of the people slaughtered by Hamas in that attack in Kibbutz Beri is like one of the most peace-loving kibbutzes in Israel, that they've donated tens of thousands of dollars to making peace and getting, you know, Palestinians to Israeli hospitals. They were one of the most aggressive in terms of seeking out a peaceful solution. And those were the people that were attacked in this situation. And I do wonder whether, you know, it's very convenient for Netanyahu to have lost the greatest enemies within his own government in the process of giving him an excuse to then go and, you know, bomb Gaza into the Stone Age.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I couldn't agree more with what you've said there. Look, there are incredible Israelis, even if they believe in the occupation. There are incredible people, even if they have a different opinion to us. You know, we're all a product of our narrative. We make decisions depending on what we believe in and what we think is true. And to a lot of Israelis, they honestly believe that the Palestinian nation wants to kill them all. I mean, it's a fundamental part of their decision making. And you know, to someone like me, it's ridiculous, right? Because I've never, ever in my life, ever, ever, ever met a Palestinian that says we should kill all the Jews and we should fight for Tel Aviv. You know, I've never met one. I know there are crazy terrorists who say that, but I've never, ever met one, a human who even thinks that that's a thing. But this thing is really real to some Israelis. You know, I know a friend who I count as a friend now, but he's extremely right wing from the, like, what I would call a supremacist, terrorist, carnist organization. Okay. And he genuinely believes that we want to kill them all. Okay. But he's a great human because he looks after so many people, and he helps, you know, black Jewish people in Israel. And he does this great peace thing. And, you know, so the idea that we will judge a person just because of their narrative, it's not fair. You know, there are great Israelis who believe in the occupation just because they can't examine their ideas properly. Look, and there are so many incredible Jewish people and Israeli people who are doing so much work for peace, putting their bodies on the line, helping Palestinian farmers under attack by settlers, going to jail for not serving. Like, you know, there are incredible people in that movement. And also they have an amazing history of fighting for social justice, for black people in the USA, with the ANC in South Africa, like this beautiful heritage of supporting social justice. And that heritage isn't gone. It's a very strong, and we salute them for that, because there's so many doing incredible work. That's the main thing to remember, is we're just a product of our upbringing most of the time, and it's really hard to break free of that. And making enemies of somebody on the other side is a dumb thing to do. We oppose the policies of the Israeli state. We are not enemies of the Israeli people, and we want to build connections with the Israeli people. In fact, on Saturday after the school strike rally, I'm going to a mediation thing with held by an Israeli man who's you know, trying to promote this peaceful trauma healing dialogue between Palestinians and Israelis. So there's, you know, there are incredible people trying to bridge gaps and do amazing things. And you know, we oppose the state, not the people. I think that's the most important thing to remember. And also, you know, yes, you know, Hamas is valuable to Israel in terms of having an enemy. But to be honest, this Likud party, these fascists, as you call them, and they absolutely are, they call themselves fascists openly. Or some of them, their aim is to take all of the land, you know, and it always has been. So the idea that they need an enemy or an excuse to do it is valid, but I think that they'll find one anyway. They'll create one anyway. So yes, it's you know, Hamas is valuable to them in terms of, you know, aggression and fighting and taking more land. But I think they'll be able to do it with or without. You know, Hamas didn't used to exist back then, but they're still doing it. They'll just find a way.
Yeah, it's hard not to lapse into conspiratorial thinking. And when you think about just the fact that this government, they were on the way out before this war broke out. And there's now, you know, I read a Financial Times report that said that they were warned of this attack weeks earlier. They knew something was coming, and it's hard not to start to think that this has just worked out so perfectly for a government that was clearly about to be ousted, if not by a democratic result, then by like a popular uprising on the streets, like unprecedented scenes in Israel. And that to me speaks volumes for the will of the Israeli people, that they'd had a gutful of these, you know, essentially Nazis running their country, and that they were, that the Likud party was jeopardizing the stability and safety and peace of the entire region, and they were marching to get rid of them, and then all of a sudden this terrorist attack happens that the Israeli government had been warned was coming. And those protests, obviously, they're finished completely. I've seen Orthodox Jews, videos of Orthodox Jews protesting against the indiscriminate bombing of Palestinians, getting just beaten mercilessly by Israeli police in the streets of Israel. So like, good luck protesting against the government in a time of war. They'll literally just beat you and lock you up.
The Palestinian experience. We've been dealing with this level of this crushing level of violence for non-violent protests that we do for decades, you know, and now the Israeli government has grown so fascist that it's doing it to its own people, and it's only now they're paying attention, you know. You know, when all those hundred thousands of people marched against Netanyahu, no one was standing up for the Palestinians, or so few of that number was looking at the real elephant in the room. You know, they were saying, oh, look, they're breaking our democracy, right? But as a Palestinian, I'm here to tell you, you don't have a democracy. Apartheid is not a democracy, okay? When you have to lock up half of the population in your country away when you vote, and they're not allowed to, or the ones that are allowed to are only a small cross-section, so they can't affect your democracy. You're apartheid, right? When all those 100,000 people were marching and saying, oh, you're destroying our democracy, no one was talking about the real problem, which is there isn't a democracy. You've got a fascist state that is imposing apartheid on half of your population. Right. And this is the problem in Israel. And this is why Palestinians will look at this and say, well, really, do you really want democracy? Because if you do, we'll join you and oust Netanyahu. Right. You know, but there was nothing like that. There was no invite for us to help make an alliance to oust Netanyahu. No, it was like, this is our democracy. And it's very telling. OK, but yes, Netanyahu, every time he's down in the polls, just before there's always a war or a flare up in the conflict. It's been a pattern all the way through his leadership. You know, so many times people were saying, oh, my God, he's going to be out. Thank God. Look how far down in the polls he is. And every time there's been this like massive flare up, this massive war, and he's got back in. So it's you know, it's not just one time. It keeps happening all the time. And obviously we don't have proof of anything, but it does. It does seem ridiculously convenient.
Mm, yeah. And the Israeli Secret Service, Mossad, are among the most conniving. And you know that they're in the corner of the Likud party. You know that they're the descendants of that original 1948 group of armed settlers looking to seize land. And yeah, it's always going to be almost impossible to prove. They're so sophisticated. They have the full backing and resources of this cutting edge in American surveillance and military technology, much of which is tested on Palestinians first. It's like a little petri dish for the military industrial complex down there. And you mentioned how many people have been locked up or prevented from protesting who are Palestinian. Right now, we're seeing the release of a lot of these political prisoners. It's part of this this truce, this ceasefire, this exchange of hostages that Hamas took for Palestinian prisoners. And this narrative, again, is being manipulated. I see that American Jewish comedian Michael Rapaport, who is just he's a famous guy. He's been in a lot of American films. He's got a huge social media following, and he is a raging Zionist, just ranting about the fact that the Palestinians being released from prison are criminals, and the hostages being released by Hamas are innocent people, hostages. And this is inaccurate, to say the least. And I'm just going to read a little bit from a Democracy Now! Report, and I recommend everyone get their news from Democracy Now! They're a quality independent organization funded by donations. So here's what Democracy Now! Had to say about this political prisoner for hostage exchange. Israel routinely arrests and detains, sometimes indefinitely, Palestinians on allegations of, air quotes, terrorism. Thousands of Palestinians are currently held in prisons today, including for alleged acts like throwing stones at occupation soldiers or raising a Palestinian flag. Some of these prisoners have now been released by Israel in exchange for hostages captured by Hamas on October 7. So here's the breakdown by the numbers. More than 7,000 Palestinian political prisoners are incarcerated in Israeli prisons. Approximately 30% of Palestinian political prisoners are held in administrative detention or indefinite incarceration without charge or trial. 200 children are among the Palestinian political prisoners incarcerated by Israel. Approximately 700 Palestinians have been deemed missing and likely detained in occupation prisons since October 7. At least 6 Palestinians have died in Israeli detention since October 7, when the terrorist attacks took place. At least 112 Palestinians have been arrested since the beginning of the temporary truce between Israel and Hamas.
Yeah, and of the 300 people released, I think the number is 124 of them were children. I think a further 140 odd were children when they were arrested, or the majority of them were children when they were arrested, I think it's a really ridiculously large number. Among them is a 15-year-old girl. A very large number, 200 or so, more than 200, were never charged of anything. So prisoner is the wrong term, okay? This narrative of one side are, you know, these sort of innocent hostages and the other side are not innocent is totally untrue. One of the people released, a lady, was a 16-year-old when it happened. Settlers came up to her and started ripping her hijab off, and she was trying to stop them doing it. And they arrested her and put her in jail for like 12-year sentence or something. Like, it's crazy, you know, the repression we get. The idea that the Israeli occupation forces never take hostages is being blown away by testimony after testimony after testimony. If they want you and they can't get you, quite often they'll just take a member of your family until you surrender. You know, that is a thing that happens and has been reported by Amnesty, the torture of people's children, sometimes in front of them, so you can watch your child being tortured. That's hostages. That is absolutely hostages. When Israeli troops take 14-year-olds and tie them to the front of their vehicles, chain them to the front of their vehicles, that's human shields, you know. This narrative that only Palestinian side take hostages and the Israeli side never do is absolutely not true. Look, the Israeli side has arrested more people, we view that as taking hostages, okay, since October the 7th, for no charge than the Palestinian nation has ever taken in Israel. We view every time they come in and they snatch a child from their home and take him off and torture them and try to break their will, okay? We view that as kidnapping and hostage taking, okay? Let's call it what it is. This colonial language is not okay, right? The level of abuse and kidnapping and hostage taking from the Israeli occupation, okay, is way more than the Palestinian population. And the idea that Israel cares about these hostages that have been taken, like really cares about, like makes policy to change to, it's rubbish. They killed so many of them trying to return to Gaza, and they've bombed Gaza so much that they're bound to have killed so many of the hostages, okay? The hostages is a thing that is being used as a kind of shock factor to justify the war. You know, this thing where one side is allowed to take hostages but the other side is not tenable, okay? If the Palestinian nation were allowed to attack Israel every time it took a hostage or kidnapped a child, you know, then we'd be in war all the time, because they do that all the time. I think it's really important that one side aren't hostages and the other side are political prisoners. They're either both political prisoners, okay, or they're both hostages.
It's a good point. And it's so easy to see how these situations would unfold in places like the West Bank. I mean, there's just so many factors contributing to hostility there. For starters, it's stinking hot. You've got these Israeli, these young servicemen and women who have been conscripted, often as teenagers. They're standing around with machine guns in flak jackets. There's young Palestinian youth, obviously very aware of the persecution and let's use more neutral language, just the sheer hostility between these two groups. And I think of myself as a teenager and as a young man, and I think of how I would have behaved in an environment like that, with a bunch of people, from the other side. Say, it could be, in Australian terms, it could be the next suburb over. The different, there was all this provincial fucking hoodlum hooligan activity when I was growing up, and I just picture them with guns and telling me what to do and how to live and how to function. And I imagine my response, I would have told those people to get to fuck and beat it, you scabs. Like, and then it just flows on from there. You got teenagers and people in their early 20s with guns versus hostile youths. So what's going to unfold there? Well, it's going to be conflict. And who's going to lose out in that conflict? Well, definitely the people without the machine guns and flak jackets. And the, social media channels are full of footage of super aggressive Israeli soldiers rounding up young Palestinian men generally, and there's constant reports of youths being shot dead in the streets over, who knows, maybe they threw a rock, maybe they threw a firework, whatever, just the basic kind of irritation of Israeli soldiers that a lot of these Palestinian youths are carrying out are met with force. And it's just this awful situation. There's so much hate and anger. And of course, those kids are going to end up locked up. Like, I mean, you see a similar dynamic here with our Indigenous population and the police, almost identical. And you see similar numbers of incarceration in this country with Indigenous people who are so overrepresented in the prisons. And, at the end of the day, we're occupying their land and the dynamic's identical. So it's so easy to see how situations like this unfold and why you've got 7,000 Palestinians behind bars in Israel.
Absolutely. I think it's really important to note the similarities between, the colonization here and how that's affected Indigenous people. I'm not obviously Indigenous in any way, but I grew up with many, many Black friends in London, and listening to what they said was really important, because it really solidified the deaths in custody, the abuse, the police aggression. The difference between that and here is the colonization, the massacres, the ethnic cleansing, the racist laws, the dispossession, the taking of children, the attempt to erase the culture and the very existence as a culture of people. And I think we're seeing that in Palestine, but we're seeing it in real time as the actual ethnic cleansing and the actual massacres are happening. And that's really the difference between that here. It's mostly in the past. There are still Black people being killed just for being Aboriginal or First Nation by police. But the difference between that and Palestine is we're actually seeing the colonization and ethnic cleansing in real time with real modern weapons broadcast live for the world to see. We can't pretend that, we would have helped Aboriginal people here and look at Palestine and say, oh yeah, it's just a conflict, it's too complicated, they're both bad, as many people are doing. It's not a tenable position. If you believe that Aboriginal people here, Indigenous people here, you can't justify what happened to them, I think you also have to look at Palestine and say, we can't justify what we're seeing in real time right now, the colonization of ethnic cleansing of this indigenous group of people. And those things are really tied together, but we can do something to change it now while it's happening. Whereas we can only heal mostly, of course it's ongoing as well for indigenous, but we can mostly heal and make it better for indigenous. But for Palestinians, we can actually stop it happening, you know, and that's really why the Palestinian issue is so important. It's almost like a testing ground for, does human rights matter at all anymore? You know, we've got all these human rights that are supposed to be obeyed, and apartheid supposed to be boycotted. It is a legal obligation to be boycotted by every corporation, every individual, and every government. And every individual has a legal responsibility to boycott apartheid, right? We've got human rights in terms of occupation, human rights in terms of return to our homes. And all of those are so blatantly ignored that actually, does human rights matter at all anymore? Can they just be ignored whenever they feel like it? And the Palestine issue now is almost a testing ground, really, for does international law matter at all? If it does, it needs to be applied now, because this is so blatant. It's so over the top that if we ignore it in an international law setting, actually international law just doesn't matter anymore, because it is pointless.
Absolutely. And there will be blowback from the Arab world, the hardline Islamic world. If the West fails to act on its principles and values and what it says it stands for, there will be comeuppance, and that comeuppance will be an increase in terrorist activity all across the Anglosphere. So you have to, one way or another, there we will be called to answer on the failure to act on these values. Really interesting, just with regards, I lost my train of thought there. It's gone. But yeah, mate, talk about solutions for this. Like for me, like when I zoom out on all this, I look at really just the role of trauma in conflicts like this. You know, PTSD, let's say, is the most common strain that really unites Palestinian and Israeli people. And you know, one of the problems with PTSD is that it's much easier to exist in a state of perpetual conflict than in a state of peace. Like, you're wired for conflict. Stress is an addiction. The conflict gives you purpose and meaning, having an other to fight. Like, and I look at the activities of the Likud party, and I'm just like, these guys are just screaming with a collective PTSD, and there it's this fight, this kind of holy fight, this righteous fight is what gets them through life. It's what gives them meaning. If you took it away, they'd just be left with themselves and their trauma and their pain. So better to kind of project that pain onto this evil other. And the same could be said for Hamas and those in Palestine who are, you know, whether it be throwing rocks at Israeli soldiers or shooting fucking rocket launches over the wall. Like, it's the same mentality on both sides. So, and I look at the same themes in indigenous culture. Like, it really is trauma at the root of it all, why they end up incarcerated and why they end up in these awful kind of conflicts with police and authorities. You know, another factor of PTSD is just the rejection of authority. You know, depression, PTSD, those two things are perfectly intertwined. And one of the symptoms is just, yeah, rejecting authority, rejecting people telling you what to do. Even if they're telling you to do the right thing, you just object to being told. So these are deep psychological wounds that need to be mended before we move on. And ironically, like, Israel is on the very forefront, probably the home of like psychedelic assisted trauma therapy, like MDMA therapy in particular, which has been shown to be the most efficacious for treating PTSD. Yeah, they were the pioneers of these trials and had an incredible success with it. I think it's like 2/3 of people with PTSD are cured after just two therapeutic sittings. So in Australia now, we have a role here to play because we're the first country in the world to legalize psychedelic assisted therapy. The problem is it's just been so slow to roll out due to various, you know, bureaucratic wheels turning in motion and whatever. So my view for a solution is, you know, Australia, let's not export military aid to Israel. Let's export, you know, battalions of trauma therapists to go into these communities with this silly little compound, just a bunch of crystals in a fucking red and yellow cap, and heal trauma en masse. I don't see any other solution. All the political solutions, I don't see it amounting to anything. It's all talk. Like, that's not going to cure the central nervous systems of the thousands of ravaged, war-ravaged, trauma-ravaged people in this region and all over the world. I did remember what I was going to say, and that was that so the thing that concerns me when you talk about, you know, applying human rights to this situation is that there is a huge chunk of the white colonial Anglosphere population that just flatly believes that resource and land theft is justified purely to buttress the fairly decadent lifestyles that we have in the West. You know, there's still so many people that consider Arabs and indigenous people as less than or savages, and they just don't really give a fuck that their land's being stolen. And that concerns me because, at the end of the day, like we no longer, it's not the 1940s anymore. You know, we have automation technology, that generates obscene abundance. There's no need to struggle for resources anymore. We fucking won as a species. We came up with a solution to these problems of scarcity, which is essentially what powers land theft, this fear that we're going to fucking run out of stuff, or we won. It's over. We don't have to fight over resources anymore. Like, there's enough to go around, isn't there?
I think it's really vital to separate, like, you know, most people from, you know, they say that one out of every 200 or some people say out of one out of every 100 people is a psychopath, an actual psychopath, you know. And so, yeah, if you ask the other 99.5% of people, should we, you know, without the context and the brainwashing, hey, should we go to this place and kill all these people and take all their resources, you know? Without any context, the vast majority of people going, no, like no, actually, you know, we shouldn't do that. Like, culture has moved. Like, maybe 200 years ago, we'd go park our battleship somewhere and take whatever we wanted, and people would be like, by jingo, let's do it, right? But now, you know, human beings have progressed so far that they have to lie like hell to make us believe this stuff, whereas before we'd accept it and it'd be fine. And I think now, you know, we as a species, especially culturally, we're moving forward so fast. You know, we don't want discrimination and racism in many, many ways, in many forms, and we abhor, injustice and all these things as a collective species. But that 100, one out of 100 or 200 people, they're not the same as us. They're not suffering from this kind of trauma. They're you know, Netanyahu is, and you know, I'm just picking on him, but there are just so many, are I believe actual psychopaths, and they are making decisions from a place of, you know, power, greed, evil, you know, joy in dominating. And so we have to be really careful of equating, like, human nature with the actions of these people and saying we're just them, you know, because we're so traumatized. I think that there is a distinction between the actions of people who are traumatized, and they can do bad things. Of course they can, and they can breed hatred and things like that. But I think that's sort of solvable in these ways that you're talking about, you know, MDMA treatment. By the way, there's a Palestinian a doctor right here where I live who's an expert in psychedelic treatment of people with depression and mental health issues, and he's absolutely incredible human. But yeah, I think we have to be careful to not diagnose the people who make decisions as just, you know, a traumatized people who are making bad decisions. I think their brain's makeup is very different to ours, and we see that in all pyramid structures where these sort of groups of people are so attracted to the top of this pyramid, and they'll only recruit from people who are like them. So you get this sort of revolving door of psychopaths getting to these most powerful positions. And our challenge is to not identify with them and create our own things, our own grass movements, like information, like what you're doing, and create our own grass movements, grass level movements, that produce the kind of things that we want, rather than just fight against them. We need to produce for ourselves as well. And I think that's a vital way of coming through. So if we want to produce healing, then those things are amazing initiatives. And you know, the drugs are great. I believe there's more MDMA per person is consumed in Israel than in any other country.
Correct. So, yes.
Yeah. So, you know, those guys, they know how to do that stuff. And who doesn't remember? Well, I do, you know, taking MDMA and going, oh man, peace and love, you know, wanting to hug everyone, and just having that experience makes it possible to see another world.
Yeah. And then Hamas kicks the door down to your music festival where you're doing that unopposed and ransacks the joint. How crazy, how convenient for the Likud party.
Yeah. Yeah. It seems to be that the peace movement in Israel, which is the most beautiful peace movement, is the least protected by the Israeli military. You know, those guys are not people who are supported by the military. They're people who are suppressed by the military. So the idea that Israel didn't perhaps protect them as well as other, I mean, it took hours. This was like 6 hours later after they broke out, wasn't it? It was like a very, very, very long time. They were like a last resort to protect or something. Like, it's really, it's not right. I bet if there was like a settler headquarters anywhere near there or something, there'd be like so much military sent there to protect them in a heartbeat. Honestly, but we're just speculating. I mean, it's very convenient for Netanyahu to boost his poll ratings. It's very convenient that the community that oppose him are the ones that suffered so horribly that from that atrocity and war crime that Hamas committed, inexcusable, of course. And you know, it's just very, the least, very, very, very convenient.
Mm. Speaking of hidden motivations and incentives, an incredible book's just hit the stands by Clinton Fernandez, a former Australian intelligence officer and now professor of international and political studies at the University of New South Wales. So I'm just going to read a review of this book from Arnaud Bertrand, who's another kind of commentator, a savvy one. So this is what he has to say about, you know, this is applies to all of the, I guess we call them allies of America. Australia is one, Israel is one, but they've actually kind of come up with a different name. They call it in this book, which is the title, a sub-imperial power. And this is what Bertrand has to say. The book makes one of the best descriptions of the, quote, rules-based international order that I've read, describing in detail how Australia isn't a vassal or a client state of the US, like many believe, but rather a sub-imperial power. What this means is that Australia, as well as other sub-imperial powers like Israel or the UK, are essentially the henchmen of the US's current imperial rule, tasked with preserving it in their respective regions, which means that as henchmen, they aren't so much victims of a hegemonic US rule, but instead feel they derive such disproportionate benefits from it that they're willing to go to the great length to help the US preserve this rule against the actual victims, those who disproportionately lose out from the order. One of the most interesting aspects of the book is how it departs from the theories of realism championed by the likes of John Mearsheimer or Stephen Walt, who assert that all states, regardless of culture, religion, social hierarchy, or political system, will act in the same way because they all prioritize survival and security above all else. They assert that given that maximizing power is the best way to survive in the international system, if they had the opportunity, all states would seek to become hegemons like the US is today, or Imperial Britain was yesterday. Fernandez makes a very different case, which I actually think is a far better explanation of how the world actually works and of the historical behavior of various states. His point is that there's something unique about US geopolitics and that of Western colonial states before it, in that they have these extremely aggressive characteristics, the impulse to subjugate and pillage others that actually often harm their security rather than safeguard it. And he explains this with the undue power the moneyed class has over the state in those systems of government, which is hard to deny if one looks at things historically. For instance, it is the East India Company that initiated the colonization and pillage of India, not the British state, that only came afterwards to essentially pacify a growing rebellion in India so as to perpetuate the ongoing pillage. Or take a more recent example, the war in Iraq. It makes very little sense from an American security or survival perspective, but it makes eminently good sense from a US oil company or economic hegemony perspective. Or again, the current conflict in Gaza, which is extremely negative for American security as it generates busloads of hatred throughout the Muslim world against America and diverts American attention from more consequential geopolitical challenges. But it makes sense if you look at it from the standpoint of perpetrating a hegemonic system. In other words, Fernandez's point is that the key characteristic of the, quote, rules-based international order relates to the actual structure of the American or British, French, Australian, Israeli, etc., social and economic system, which seeks to enforce an order where the whole world is open to the penetration and control of their respective national moneyed classes, which is why the order is about hegemony and not about security, and why the former so often comes at the expense of the latter. It's interestingly something that John Mearsheimer often laments about if you listen to him. Why would the US act in such foolish ways that go against what my realist theories recommend? Mearsheimer, by the way, just did a podcast with Lex Friedman that is an amazing listen and I recommend everyone to listen to. Mearsheimer was adamantly opposed to the war in Iraq, warned for many years about the risk of a clash with Russia in Ukraine if we expanded NATO, and keeps speaking out against the US's unequivocal support of Israel. And by doing so, Mearsheimer actually admits that realism doesn't quite explain the behavior of states and that his theories are therefore not quite right. Fernandez here offers an explanation that better predicts the actual behavior of the US and its sub-imperial powers. You cannot understand states' behavior if you limit yourself to a state-centric view. You also need to look at the unique characteristics of their political, social, and economic system. A last interesting point is that, given the fact he argues that states' political and economic systems play a key role in defining their geopolitics, Fernandez's book implies a prediction that as China's power rises, it will behave in a vastly different way than the US and its imperial henchmen. Given the Chinese system, it will undoubtedly seek to maximize its power, but this time it will actually be for its own security and survival and not to serve the interests of its moneyed class, and as such will behave in much less aggressive ways than the US. Again, interestingly, Mearsheimer kind of admits this too, because he repeatedly says, when I am in China, I'm amongst my people, as in they follow his realist theories much more faithfully than the US. We can already see the contours of this. It's absolutely obvious that the Chinese state isn't at the mercy of its moneyed class. Quite the contrary. China is not exactly a country where billionaires have an easy life. Same thing with respect to hegemony. China doesn't do military alliances. It doesn't have any foreign interference. It doesn't do foreign interference or coup d'etats. In fact, they haven't as much fired a single bullet abroad in over four decades. On the contrary, it seeks to create an order with indivisible security and mutual respect embedded in the system, where it'd ideally be the most powerful state, sure, but not for the purpose of pillaging or subjugating others, but because this guarantees its security and stability, which is exactly how it behaved for 1800 years when it was the most powerful state on the planet before the Industrial Revolution. It never went around trying to colonize and pillage the world, as it believed this would eventually come at the expense of its own security, much like it comes at the expense of American security and interests today. Instead, it sought relationships of trade and mutual respect that maximize security and stability over the long term. So, yeah. Thoughts?
I mean, about America, absolutely, yes. I mean, America, the US does things against the interest of their people constantly.
As does Israel in this case.
As does Israel, absolutely. The idea in Israel's case is that the land that they are trying to steal from the Palestinian nation and take comes with a price of Israeli citizens, and they know that. They're willing to give up the lives and security of their own citizens to fight a war stealing someone else's land. But America is a different thing. The American politics is so ruled in this sort of plutocracy or oligarchy where politicians really don't have the sort of power that we think that they might have. They seem to me to be kind of like managers of the political wishes of the elites. They make decisions constantly that are bad for the USA as a state. But these decisions are really, really good for certain corporations, which wield an incredible amount of power in the US. And to analyze it, like, I think Cenk Uygur, his name escapes me straight away from CNN. He used to work at CNN, amazing Turkish guy who, he says that the MIT research shows that whoever raises the most money in America wins 97% of the time. So basically, whoever's got the biggest amount of money to spend on advertising is going to get into power. So as a politician, my job is to get as much money as possible. And the only way to do that is to already sell out to corporations, right? So the system is rigged in a way that my job as a politician is to do what you want so I can get the money to get voted in, okay? And then I'm going to spend that money with Fox News, with CNN, with whatever. So they're never going to talk about this system because it benefits them the most, which is why media is intrinsically messaging for politicians, you know, because they spend all that huge amount of money with the media, right? So the media has no interest in, but it's part of this system of control. So you can imagine, you know, I'm a politician, I want to be in power, so I have to raise lots of money and I want to spend it in media. And so we get this system, a broken system, which relies on politicians doing what they're told. And what they're being told is to enrich and empower a very, very small class of people and corporations. And the problem with corporations is they necessarily act like psychopaths. The mental breakup, the mental analysis of a corporation is a psychopath, if it were a human.
Yeah, it's the cognitive dissonance between this endless growth model on a finite planet. That's how every corporation functions psychologically. They want to create dividends for their shareholders, despite, like, endlessly. In otherwise, the corporation folds. It doesn't function anymore, right? But this is not possible because this is not the planet that we live on.
That's right. And Noam Chomsky says this really, really well. He's like, this is not a system of just evil people making evil choices, right? The system itself, like he says, you know, JP Morgan is owned by this guy and he's got two options. One, he can invest in the worst kind of polluting fracking because it's the most profitable, right? The second choice he has is to resign and let someone else do it, right?
Yeah, fuck. That's so true.
right? So it's not an individual problem, right? It's not these like little cabal of really evil people doing these really ridiculously evil things, right? It's systemic capitalism that will lead to a breakdown.
It has to.
It's unfettered. It can't not lead to a breakdown, you know? So that, and that's the problem we're facing. It's not like, you know, there's, you know, we have to take these horrible people away and then everything will be okay. No, we have to fundamentally center human rights and ecological rights at the center of all our decision making. It's only when we do that that we come up with good decisions, I feel. You know, if we make that the central policy of where all decisions come from, then we have a way of being able to make decisions without the propaganda. You know, if a propaganda says this and it's against human and ecological rights, then it's not the right thing to do. We have to just place that as a central point of all the decisions we make.
Well said. And I heard a Chinese commentator in John Pilger's amazing film, must-see film, The Coming War with China, make this point that the key difference between China and America, the political systems, is that in America, the political system is subject to capital. Capital rules. In China, capital does not rule. What rules is this centralized communist government. And so that's the difference. So look, I'm not here to freaking justify China's way of doing things, but you must also realize that, like the coverage of this war, like the coverage of basically anything you care to name in this capitalist-powered media paradigm that we're existing in, the coverage of China is also completely flawed and completely upside down. So I really recommend as a start point The Coming War with China to better understand this supposed giant threat that we're dealing with. Speaking about, you mentioned just the importance of pushing back on this broken system, and that is something that you're actually involved in. You've done some time on blockades at Adani and in Newcastle. Can you tell us a bit about that work?
Yeah, I've always tried to be involved in the work, the most important work around. So, you know, in England, poll tax and rights and all that stuff, and that's carried on to here. You know, the activist community, you know, supports each other in many ways, and many of us are not just like single issue people. Like, we care about this one thing. No, we care about human rights and environmental rights being central points. So here in Australia, you know, engaging against Adani or coal is the most, you know, one of the most important issues alongside Aboriginal First Nations rights is the central struggle of this. When we fight against the corruption that allows, you know, environmental destruction, and the corruption that allows an unjust criminal system to flourish, it's that same corruption that we talked about, you know. And so when you fight again for Palestinian rights, you're still fighting against that same corruption. You know, our battle is because it's a system, it's not just one thing. Our fights are intrinsically the same. We are fighting the same corruption. And so it's vital, I think, that the activists support each other, they learn from each other, and that we're not just single issue people, that we show up to support other activists in because they also need our support, because we're starting from a position of human rights and environmental rights. So we need to care about all types of oppression, and we need to action that. And tomorrow night we're doing an activist workshop, learning activism skills from like legendary activists. People who just were arrested the other day down in Newcastle on the flotilla, people who have been teaching about activism, people who have written books about activism. And we're all going to get together and learn the skills that we need and help each other with our different things. The Greens will be there. We'll you know, and we'll learn how to support each other and we'll learn skills from each other. I think that's vitally important that we view all these struggles as this essentially the same struggle.
Mate, well done. I'm going to send you a cupcake because you just perfectly described intersectionality without using that word, which I think is a fucking stupid word that goes over the heads of every working class person. But essentially what you've said is that workers' rights, Palestinian rights, environmental rights, it's you're protesting against the same person, the same thing, the same system is responsible for the crimes against all these. So therefore we must unite the resistance and we may as well, when we're protesting against one thing, we may as well protest against them all because it's the same fucking thing.
Yes. And I think it's you know, people perhaps think that they're hijacking an issue if they talk about another issue at the same time. But I think it's important. Like, we always present, you know, West Papua, East Sudan, like all these other places as part of our family. And it's important that we message for all of them at the same time in terms of human rights. But also, you know, obviously the planet is completely, you know, one thing. So when we fight for that here, we also fight for it in Brazil, the Amazon and Siberia that's, you know, logged to pieces and all those, and the ocean, you know, these things are all, as you said, like completely tied together. And the only way we can make progress is to all get behind the issues of each other. But I think there is that little thing where we don't want to, you know, completely take a message away from one group. So we have to join them rather than put our message on top of their message.
Yeah, it just points to the fact that really what's needed is more general strikes, you know, like don't tie it to any one of these causes. They'll figure it out. The strike is what is important. Crippling economies is how you and corporations is how you get your message across in this system, and that's what the boycott, divest and sanction movement is. That, you know, Roger Waters from Pink Floyd is one of the key advocates of that, and that's something that's aimed at Israel and penalizing Israeli and American and just basically Western corporations that fund this kind of activity. Mate, can you quickly detail for us what went down in Newcastle? Because, I mean, that's one of the spiritual homes of this podcast, and it was pretty big time. You know, we saw activists who were like 97-year-old working class iconoclasts getting arrested. So can you tell us a little bit about what that was about and what the outcome was?
Sorry, I just got to plug in my thing. That's why I'm moving. Yeah, actually, I'm waiting to hear like more firsthand evidence from you know, people who were there on Thursday. It was an incredible action. You know, these are the sorts of actions that inspire people. They tell our youth that this is a struggle that is important, that people are willing to get up and get arrested. It forces the media to not ignore the issue, to show how passionate some people are about the issue. It actually brings so much attention to these polluters. And these sorts of actions are vital. I mean, they are the sort of breach by which everyone can follow, and the sort of guiding principles are just impeccable. The organizers organize in a way where their principles and their actions are always non-violent. Everyone is cared for. And the rights of everyone involved, even the police and the workers, are always considered. These are incredible, peaceful actions that make a real concrete difference. And bless that man, that old guy, and all the young people, and all those people. To me, they're absolute heroes and legends. And an inspiration, I think, for for more people to follow and are vital. Just being around a few of the people and having friends of friends in common, I know that these are incredible people who've done, you know, years of sacrifice to you know, try and save our planet and possibly our children and their children's lives, you know. So they're heroes for me.
And it's interesting to know some of these protest actions are going down at the ports. You know, we're a big island, and the maritime union in this country is right on the forefront of this intersectional fight. And I really encourage people to rally behind the MUA and get in behind them. And mate, don't poke the fucking bear. Don't fuck with the Anzac spirit, man. Yeah, we don't need reminding of the unscrupulous, murderous nature of British aristocrats in this joint, or colonial powers. We were a convict colony. It's in our history that thousands of our family members were sent to die at Gallipoli for no good reason by aristocratic generals drinking tea and fucking eating scones. So, mate, you know, we have the opportunity to set an example for the world here, as we've done in the past. With Julian Assange, and I mean, maybe this is the world's karma, the imperialists' karma, that they lock up one of our own for doing nothing else than telling the truth, and maybe this sub-imperial power is about to throw off the shackles and partner up with someone else in our region.
Absolutely. And you mentioned, you know, sending people to war at Gallipoli, you know, against the Turkish people. I think it's important that not many people know that Palestinians fought alongside Anzac troops in World War I. We fought for your freedom. And in World War II, we again fought for the freedoms, you know, against the Nazis. My grandfather served for the British. And it's important to note that we fought for your freedom. And now we're asking you, after your governments have repeatedly ignored, broken their promises for our freedom, we're asking you now to fight for our freedom also, in the same way that we did for you, Australian people. And Australian people are incredible. I love being here. That thing for battling for underdogs, for the sense of fairness, the way Australians would think of nurses and doctors and firefighters as heroes. The volunteering culture of Australian society, how so many volunteer for great causes to help other people. This is a culture that I love for that. Like, it's incredible amount of fairness and support people. And I think, you know, many Australians don't realize they have that beauty in their culture and it's incredible to be part of, and the environmentalism in Australia too. And I think it's the divestment and boycott is the most important thing that Palestinians are asking. We've been begging activists all over the world to engage in the boycott, because that's the only non-violent way to really get through. You know, you mentioned earlier about how Palestinians and Israelis can come together and make the situation better. I don't think it's going to happen in that way. I think the only way it's going to happen is from outside pressure to pressure a real conversation. At the moment, what we're not seeing that. And when, you know, when football teams won't come to Israel, when academics won't go to Israel, when bands and musicians won't go to Israel, and that becomes a really big sustained thing, I think then the people of Israel will realize, oh, you know, but perhaps we are the bad guys. And until they're forced, I think, to see it in that way, or at least some of them see it in that way, I don't think the connection that we make between our people and their people will be strong enough to bring about change internally. I think the boycott, just like in South Africa, you know, the boycott is a divestment and sanctions movement is possibly the only way we're going to make those conversations happen in any real way.
Mate, and a bunch of pro surfers, including the two-time world champ Tom Carroll, including my hometown hero Shane Horan, at the pointy end of that action against South Africa over apartheid. And I've spoken to those guys and they've said that it's time again. The time has come again, and it will be amazing to see some world tour athletes take a stand for peace and dignity. And we're seeing it, you know. Tyler Wright, former women's world champ, like, you know, she's very much on the front foot with stuff like this. And yeah, it really is incumbent upon us. I mean, yeah, to stand up against this, it has to be, because no one else is going to do it.
And an Australian's voice is worth what, 10,000 Palestinians' voices? You know, like a Palestinian,
100,000 American voices. Fuck, those guys talk so much shit. The septic tanks. Wow.
Yeah, you know, like the privilege here in Australia to be able to affect change, you know, that our voices are so powerful here, you know, and Americans, of course, but you know, we a voice of a Palestinian in Gaza is voiceless, and a voice of a Palestinian in the West Bank is tiny compared to the kind of power we have to affect change. We are so privileged here to have that, you know, and to be able to demonstrate, to be able to boycott, to be able to meet without repression. You know, we're the ones that can really make change. We really are. We're the change makers, you know, and our ability to engage non-violently, but unshakably, is really the only thing that will make a difference in Palestine and Israel and reduce the suffering, which is the absolute main thing. The suffering going on there is so bad, is indescribable for many people living there, and I think we have to keep that as a thing to remember. It's not, when there's less violence, that suffering is not reduced, it's constant, you know. So we are really privileged, and we're able to make these changes in an easy and non-violent way. To engage in the BDS movement is easy. It doesn't take a lot of time. It literally, you just send a letter to your super saying, hey, do you guys invest in this? You send a letter to your bank saying, hey, do you guys invest in this? You know, you just sign up to a BDS newsletter. And if they say, oh, if they send you a message saying, how can you sign this petition for us? Just sign it, man. It takes like 30 seconds. They don't spam you. They're very careful with not annoying people. It's a super easy thing to do, you know. The other thing people can do and is join APAN, which is the Australian Palestinian Advocacy Network. And they're really the people that try and get policy here to change and try and support the Palestinian narrative to counter that demonization and othering of the Palestinian nation and the sort of almost supremacist narrative that an Israeli's life is worth so much more than a Palestinian's. You know, APAN is an amazing organization. I was at their annual general meeting last night by Zoom, and you know, they're incredible people who work tirelessly, and those two organizations actually are the way that Australian activists can most easily and really make a difference to what's going on. And we absolutely implore everyone to engage in those two campaigns, those two organizations and their campaigns.
Unreal, Subhi. Thank you so much for your time, mate, and your work and your service. Legendary.
Oh, and yours. Like, your podcast is awesome, dude. Like, I've got lots of catching up to do, but it's just dope. And I'm so glad for you doing what you're doing. As you said, independent media, we you know, it is a massive service to social and environmental justice, and we appreciate you so much for what you're doing, bro. It's just great work.
Thank you, brother. Take care. I'll speak to you soon, no doubt.